I'd like to welcome all of our panelists, most especially our members, our visitors, elected officials, and otherwise. We're pleased to have you here with us. Thanks to Dennis Marr and Bob Evans on the technical side today, to Beverly Bean for her publicity work. She's really been getting the word out. And of course, to Janet Brennan for pulling this together for us on this sunny, dry day when we're probably all thinking about water. We have three panelists. Donna Meyers is the general manager of the Salinas Valley Basin Groundwater Sustainability Agency. Her academic training is in biology, her undergraduate degree from UC Santa Cruz, and then a master's degree in regional planning from Cal Poly. She has more than 20 years of experience in natural resource and water conservation. She has served as the executive director of, I hope I get this, the Salinas River Management Unit. She's also served as director of conservation for the Big Sur West, as regional water quality coordinator for the West Coast National Marine Sanctuary Program, and as the principal analyst for the City of Santa Cruz. And she will start us off today, but I would also like at this time to give you the bio background on our other speakers. And we have Steve McIntyre. Steve is a businessman and trained as an enologist. He is the co-founder of Monterey Pacific Incorporated, which is a viticulture management and development company, the Monterey Wine Company, and McIntyre Vineyards. He is a member and past chairman of CDFA Pierce's Disease Board, chairman of its Product Development and Research Screening Committee, a member of the California Association of Wine Grape Growers, and a graduate of the California Ag Leadership Program, previous board member of the Big Sur Land Trust, received the 2013 Wine Grape Grower of the Year Award from the Wine Grape Growers, and he studied enology at Cal State Fresno. And now you understand why I really did need to have the paperwork in front of me to get through all those distinguished credentials. And our own Janet Brennan is an environmental planner with 50 plus years of experience working for local and regional governments and nonprofits. That includes air and water quality, land use, infrastructure, hazardous waste planning, environmental review. She's been active in public interest and community groups, including the League of Women Voters, since the 1960s. So we're very proud to say that she's our past president, currently on the board of the League of Women Voters of Monterey County. She's a founding and current board member of Land Watch Monterey County. She's on the Carmel Valley Land Use Advisory Committee. She chairs that. Chamber of Music Monterey Bay Secretary, Monterey Bay Air Resources District Advisory Committee Chair. Donna, to start us off, if that's okay with you, Janet.
Yes, and I would just like to note that both Steve and I are on the board of directors of the Salinas Valley Basin Groundwater Sustainability Agency. So, you've got the whole crew here, so
nice. Great. And also before we start, Dennis has said that questions would go into the chat, and then he will moderate those for us. All right, Donna.
Well, thank you. I'm going to just do a very short PowerPoint. I'm going to breeze through a number of slides. It's hard to completely cover everything that SGMA, the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, is really doing in California, but I want to get to some of the local conditions that I know that you guys would be interested in. And I'm going to have to apologize. I have an interview with the Washington Post on the Salinas Valley Basin and SGMA at 12:45. So that just came up this morning. So I'm going to buzz over to that. But Steve and Janet are very, very well informed on all the work that we do as well. So let me just real quick, I wanted to first off just sort of introduce you all a little bit to our agency. We're formed as part of the requirements of the State Sustainable Groundwater Management Act. We are called the Salinas Valley Basin Groundwater Sustainability Agency, and we do manage and plan for the entirety of the Salinas Valley Basin, which is over 700,000 or 800,000 acres. It's one of the larger basins in California. And it's a very important area, as you all know, economically for the farming components that do come out of the basin, as well as all the communities that are in the basin as well. Our focus is really helping people understand the importance of groundwater. And as we mentioned earlier just today, that here we are sitting in another dry day. It was during the drought of 2014 to 2016 that the importance of groundwater really came home in California. And many communities don't really realize that they do use groundwater or they're part of a groundwater system. And so, you know, groundwater is really that essential source of water that is actually will protect us against some of the effects of climate change. And of course, many of us use groundwater in our homes, in our businesses. And then here locally, we have an agricultural industry, obviously, that does use groundwater primarily. Sigma also makes the point of connecting the health of our ecosystems also with groundwater. So that is sort of a unique part of what this law does. And of course, just mention that groundwater is the primary source of water in the Salinas Valley. And that's what our work focuses on. SGBA, as we call it, because everybody speaks in acronyms, it was passed in 2014, and it is the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act. This is the first time that the state of California has actually regulated groundwater in state history. And really there's three things that we want to keep in mind as we talk about our conditions of our aquifers, as well as where our groundwater sustainability plans are going. One is that there was a commitment when the bill was written that locally driven plans would be valued, and basically that would be the goal of SGBA, would be that the recognition that groundwater is managed locally, that the responsibilities of that management need to be further developed, but that sustainability really should be defined at a local level. So all of the plans that we have done as an agency have all been done through stakeholder driven processes here in the Salinas Valley. If a basin does not meet the ability to gain sustainability or fails to produce a plan for a particular basin, then the state can come in and take over the management of that aquifer. So there is that backstop of wanting to keep locally driven plans as the forefront of how to get this work done. But if either major milestones aren't met or plans are not completed, then the state can come in and has the ability to come in and actually manage the basin. The agency was formed in 2017 during the period of 2015 to 2017. We're actually a joint powers authority. SGBA allows us groundwater sustainability agencies to be formed as joint powers authorities. And we operate with an 11-member board of directors. We also have a 25-member advisory committee, and we've operated over the last 2 years with multiple sub-basin planning committees. Those will become permanent committees for the agency as well. We also have created additional committees in the past year, and I'll talk a little bit more about those. We're tasked as an agency with really developing groundwater sustainability plans. You'll start another acronym you will learn is called, which is the GSP. And we were tasked and required by the law to develop 6 GSPs for the Salinas Valley Basin. We do 2 of those in partnership. One is the Monterey GSP, and that's done in partner with Marina Coast Water District. And then we have a partnership on the Forebay GSP with the Arroyo Seco Groundwater Sustainability Agency. So really what drives us is really the timeline set by the state. And this is just a very quick map of the basins. This is the county line. We are managing these basins in color here. We do not manage the Seaside Basin, but we will and have developed plans for the Monterey, what we call the 18400 aquifer, the Langley, East Side, the Forebay, and then the Upper Valley. And to orient you, City of Salinas is in the 18400. Corral de Tierra is here in the Monterey. Highway 68 areas here. Fort Ord, obviously, you know. Langley is in the area kind of northeast of the Gabalon and the east side of the Salinas Valley there. Forebay has the communities of Soledad and Greenfield in it. And then the upper valley is really South Monterey County has the communities of Kings, has the community of King City in it. We were tasked as an agency to complete groundwater sustainability plans by the year 2022. We have completed all of those and they have been completed and sent to the state. The next thing that we have to do is shown here in this bottom part of this little diagram, which is to achieve sustainability in 20 years. And we do that by looking at six different sustainable management criteria. And I'll go into those a little bit. Once we achieve sustainability, then we have to maintain that sustainability in the base, that basin for another 30 years. So this is a very long-term planning perspective. We have been, as I mentioned, formed in 2017. In 2019, we began starting the planning process for these plans. In 2020, we completed what's called the 18400 Aquifer Subbasin Plan. We've been working over the last 2 years on developing five additional plans, and we did complete those and submit those just last month. Also concurrent with that, the agency completed a strategic plan, which you can find on our website. And then, as I mentioned, the last piece really is setting ourselves off on the process, on the pathway to integration and implementation. And that really takes place now until 2040, where we have to show that we're reaching some of these objectives that we've set, these criteria that we've set in our plans. The state and the law requires a number of, there's really six criteria that the state says you must, these are called sustainability indicators. And the state says you must develop a plan that identifies each of these indicators and where acceptable and unacceptable conditions may exist. So one is basically, are the wells in an area actually getting, are they lowering? Are they, are they getting basically overused or are you losing groundwater availability? The other is whether or not the actual storage area of an aquifer has been reduced. And I'll go into a little more details and some examples. The next indicator is whether or not an aquifer has been intruded by seawater. The fourth is whether or not the water quality in the aquifer is degraded, and that could be from various sources. It could be from chemicals associated, for example, with gas stations. It could be, use of nutrients, related to agricultural and farming, various things. But degraded water quality is another indicator. And then land subsidence, which is very common in the San Joaquin Valley, in the Central Valley, but is really not found here, is another indicator. And then whether or not your activities are actually depleting surface water. So if there's a groundwater surface water interaction, are your rivers and streams or wetlands being drained because you're drawing down the groundwater? And there's really kind of, I call this sort of the stoplight right here. We have sort of the green, yellow, and red sort of idea here with the state, which is we want to maintain things at a threshold that keep our groundwater basin healthy and moving towards sustainability or maintaining sustainability. We have to be able to measure that regularly and relate and evaluate those each year. And then when we see a problem, we've got to be able to put on basically the red light, the stoplight, and say, okay, we have an undesirable situation here. We need to start to take action. So what the GSA does is every year we take in hundreds of points of data, and we analyze and look at every single one of these basins. And we are looking at these kinds of objectives, measurable thresholds, and then the potential undesirable results. And then we need to build management practices that will address those. We have a variety of tools we can get to with regards to sustainability. Very quick little thing here. Obviously, I just talked about some of the monitoring, metering of wells, making sure we're understanding how much water is being used. We can conduct scientific studies and do complicated modeling to be able to understand the basins the best that we can. The state actually requires us to update our plans every 5 years, and every year we have to submit an annual compliance report with all the data reported for the particular area or the particular sub-basin. These are our tools in terms of moving ahead. We can actually build projects to provide more supply or to recharge, recharge waters. We can also take things like management actions, which may be allocations or demand management types of activities, water conservation, those kinds of things. So we have a big bucket of things we can do as an agency in terms of doing this. I'm eating away at time here, so I'm going to buzz through these. What I'd like you to know is that we basically have four basins that are going to be the focus of the agency in the next several years. One is the east side sub-basin. I'm going to go back to my map here. One is the basin here in yellow. This is drains the Gavilan Range and is largely an agricultural area. It also interacts with domestic water providers as well, though. This area is in overdraft currently, and we do need to address that. So that's going to be a primary focus area. The 18400 foot aquifer is the aquifer that is intruded by seawater. So that has to be a primary focus. And I'm sure many of you are familiar with the conditions there, but that has to be a primary focus of the agency. The Monterey is split into two management areas. So Marina Coast Water District manages the Ord area of that basin, and we manage the Corral de Tierra area. Here in this basin in particular, we're finding that we have some severe drawdowns of groundwater as evidenced by this graph here. So this is a graph of average changed over time from 20 to 2022. And you can see this is our red light right here. And we are below it and continuing to go below it. So this basin will require immediate action, looking at how we manage that water more equitably so we can get back to those sustainability factors. Our other basins that we have, Langley is also an overdraft. This is Langley up here. Small amount of overdraft has been documented, about 300 acre feet per year. We're going to have to look for ways to put water back into the system up here, back into the aquifer. And then finally, the Forebay and the Upper Valley aquifers, even though they were ranked as medium priority aquifers by the state, our analysis has shown right now they are in balance. And so mostly those basins will be looking to make sure that those changes, those conditions, these criteria, these indicators do not change over time in those two basins down there. So really what our agency does from here on out after we've done these plans is we create implementation plans for each of the basins. Some will be quite aggressive, some will be quite costly. We also want to raise the awareness of what groundwater is, its role in really the health and well-being of Monterey County, its relationship to the environmental conditions and our streams and our rivers and our groundwater, our wetlands. So we have a lot of stakeholder outreach and community engagement we want to do as well. So we've got to put our plans on track for immediate action right away, because we do have some significant issues in some of the basins. And at the same time, we're hoping to raise the awareness of what groundwater is, its importance, especially with regards to climate change and drought types, drought as an example. And we see our work as being very, very important over the years, and getting to sustainability by 2040 sounds like a long way away, but we know in many of these areas, it'll take a long time. So we are working right out of the gate to try to get things going. We have a small staff, just two people. So we do quite a bit of work, but our board is very dedicated, as are all of our stakeholders, to getting to work right away and addressing some of these issues. And I think I'll stop there. I do have maps of the basins with some of the conditions, and I'm happy to click on those as needed just to get people oriented. But I think in the interest of time, I'll stop there. So thank you for having me today.
Thank you very much, Steve. Please.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate this opportunity and the introduction. And Donna did a great job and has done a great job for us as our general manager. Aside from the two-person staff, we have Montgomery and Associates, the horsepower of their organization, which has been responsible for writing the plan according to our needs, so to speak. I just wanted to start out by talking a little bit about where I'm located in the Salinas Valley. I'm down in the Forebay, and we farm wine grapes in three of the four major sub-basins. So we're in the east side, Forebay and Upper Valley. We farm on down into Paso Robles, and I can say that Salinas Valley's situation is so much vastly better than Paso Robles, and seriously, vastly better than most of California. And Donna didn't say it, but kudos to the GSA for being one of the shining stars for the Department of Water Resource Agency. And we hope to continue to be, because that will afford us grants and a lot of help from the state that other areas will not be getting, because they tend to have very divisive situations and they're not necessarily working together very well. SGMA, you know, a lot of you may be asking, so, and I want to leave plenty of time for questions, because I know people want to try and understand what's happening in Salinas Valley. But SGMA is unique. We've been, of course, trying to solve saltwater intrusion and water problems in the Salinas Valley for decades, and we just haven't gotten to the finish line. But with SGMA, we have a mandate to do so, and we have timelines. And it's a different story this time. It's a much more stakeholder-driven process that many of you are involved in. It's very open. There's no backroom deals happening or anything like that. So I'm very excited as a board member and a stakeholder with the process and the progress that we've made to date. Briefly, want to touch on where we are with the drought right now. One of the unique things about the Salinas Valley is we have the two reservoirs that store water down in South County. And with that storage, we were able to release water last year up until July. That water that was released ended up where it belongs, in the ground. And in the ground, it kept our aquifers relatively full. Now that's super important, because as I stated, that's one of the few things, one of the unique things about the Salinas Valley is as compared to the rest of the state. So the effects of this current two-year drought, maybe going into its third year, we could have a March miracle, but we'll see. But the effects on the Salinas Valley and the ag economy are very limited, because as of last July, we were technically had a full groundwater levels were relatively full. And as a result, we have enough water in the ground to get us through at least 3 years. So if we don't get any more rain this year and we don't release anything from the reservoir, parts of the Upper Valley won't be affected until next year and won't be out of water until 2024. So that gives us a tremendous buffer. And what I like to tell people is we've got a marine sanctuary out there in the ocean. Well, we actually have an agricultural sanctuary, 250,000 irrigated acres that we need to protect because of the threat of food scarcity in the future, and as a strategic asset to the United States and certainly California. So getting back to SGMA, you know, we've got enough water in the watershed for, we just don't have the right distribution. And we our biggest problem, of course, is saltwater intrusion. And that's been going on for quite a length of time. So what are the solutions briefly? It's a portfolio of projects and management actions, basically. But the important thing is that these actions must be as drought-proof as possible. Relying on water running down the river to fill, you know, to utilize with our CSIP project, which, you know, provides water to farmers in the 180-400 pressure area, that's not drought proof. So one of the approaches that I'm certainly an advocate of is this extraction barrier concept. So we've got wells all along Highway 1 between Monterey and Watsonville that are brackish now. They're not seawater, they're not 19,000 parts per million, they may be 1,000, 1,500 parts per million. So using reverse osmosis, putting a well field in along Highway 1, if you would, first backing up, and then using reverse osmosis to treat that water. Reverse osmosis is a proven technology. All the aircraft carriers and submarines use it. We've been using it for years in the wine industry. We can treat that brackish water with a lot less energy, and we don't have to treat 100% of the water like we would with seawater, because it's much higher in sodium and chloride. So we could create a barrier that at minimum, would provide drinking water to the city of Salinas and Castroville and Monterey sub-basin. And if it's ultimately successful, would limit seawater intrusion any further. Now, this project would have the greatest regional impact of any of the projects that we are debating in our portfolio. And that's why I've chosen to talk about it. It would provide water, as I mentioned, for the 18400, the Castroville, Salinas. And by taking the city of Salinas in particular off of groundwater pumping, we would solve the overdraft situation in the east side for sure. And we would certainly help the Langley situation. So regionally, we'd be affecting east side, Langley, 18400, and the Monterey. That gives us the largest area possible. It gives us a drought-proof project, the largest area possible to pay for this project, and it's not going to be cheap. So how do we pay for it? So the farmers are using, we're using 85-90% of the water in the Salinas Valley. We would concentrate on getting the municipalities the water they need, Salinas, Castroville, Monterey. That would alleviate our overdraft and allow us to pump more groundwater. As I mentioned earlier, we've got enough water. It's a distribution problem, and it's a quality problem because there's plenty of water in the 18400. It just happens to be salty, and we can't use it for crops or people for that matter. So with that, I'd really like to open it up to questions that you all may have about, you know, dynamics over in the Salinas Valley, how things work. I'm happy to answer them for as long as you have time.
Thank you, Steve, for that perspective. And let's give Janet an opportunity to make her contribution, and then we will move on to the questions.
Well, I am the environmental representative on the Salinas Valley Basin Groundwater Sustainability Agency. And I tend to be the lone vote, or at least one of two people who have not always supported the efforts. And one of the critical issues is what I call the basin and the politics are hydrologically challenged. And that does not refer to water running uphill. What it refers to is the fact that the Salinas River stops going underground around Chular for all practical purposes. There may be some interconnection, and that's always a question. So in essence, what that means is the South County farmers and their basins have plenty of water. And in fact, their plans for those basins really do not require any projects to address the problems. The real problem is the North County farmers, the 18400 sub-basin and the Monterey sub-basin and the Langley sub-basin. The planning process initially started with a plan for the seawater intruded basin. And that plan foresaw a basin-wide approach in addressing the seawater intrusion problem. It looked at a basin-wide mechanism for raising funds. After that plan was completed, DWR basically came back and said, you need to do plans for the other five sub-basins within the Salinas Valley Groundwater Basin. And that planning process really ended up, in my opinion, fragmenting the overall approach to addressing the critical problems in the intruded basins. The ag community is divided substantially between North and South County farmers. And this is the elephant in the room. And I know Steve will probably want to address that particular issue. But it goes both ways. Historically, there was a basin-wide approach to pay for the Salinas Valley Water Project, which resulted in the rubber dam and water for CSIP. And South County farmers, and probably rightly so, say they have made major contributions to addressing this overall problem. And there appears to be a real reluctance to do additional funding for basin-wide approaches. And any solution to the seawater intrusion issue and the problems in the Monterey, Corral de Tierra, and Castroville area and so on are going to require very expensive projects. And my other major issue with all of that is that, one, the sub-basin plans that ultimately were approved by the board in January failed to address some key integration issues. And while, you know, the basic approach has been, we'll address that in the implementation phase, in the opinion of Landwatch and its attorney, the plans failed to meet the basic requirement of SGMA for integration. Finally, I want to address the extraction barrier. This is what Steve brought up. And while it's true that the desalinating the water in coastal wells would be far cheaper than doing seawater, the feasibility of that whole approach has been, in my opinion, underestimated. How it's going to be paid for has not really been addressed. In the Central Valley, for example, ag will pay maybe up to $1,000 per acre foot for water, but not much more, and that may be on the high side. But there are critical issues that do need a regional approach. Corral de Tierra, even if you stop pumping all the water, you're not going to solve the problem. The interrelationship between Corral, De Tierra, the Seaside Basin, and the 18400, these are critical issues. Yet Seaside is not a part of, the Seaside Groundwater Basin is not a part of the planning process. So these are some of the critical issues. I know that, you know, staff will has basically said all of this will be addressed in the implementation phase, but these issues, in my opinion, should have been more fully addressed in the initial planning process, because what we have now are six plans basically requiring more planning. So that's my perspective. And so I think all of us are ready to answer questions. Why don't we have questions from Donna first, since she has to go out for an interview with the Washington Post.
Okay, thank you. I think Donna has answered the question that was specifically asked of her. We have not only distinguished speakers, but distinguished question askers. So, and almost all of them are elected officials. So I think I'm safe to say that I'll ask them, they may, if they wish to unmute and ask their question directly. So first we'll have Karen Paul, and then Melody Krislock, and then the mayor of Allison from Delray Oaks. So Karen, would you like to unmute yourself and ask your question?
Hello, I put my question in the chat, and it was partially addressed after I put it in. It was, how is all of this going to be paid for? I mean, these are huge projects, as the speakers have said. It seems like, I don't know, what planning, what thoughts, what information can you give us on possible ways to finance these huge projects?
I'm happy to maybe take a stab at that. So thank you for the question, Karen, or Mayor. So under the law, the agency can charge what's called a regulatory fee, or it's essentially an administrative fee, if you would. We can come up with a fee-based system for a lot of what we do. There was a question previously about, you know, are we going to put meters on every well? And we do have a well registration and metering action that we will be pursuing. It's a big area, lots of wells, but we will be closing what we call the data gaps and using our fee structure to be able to work with these individual basins to identify the costs and the projects that they need to start pursuing. We have some flexibility in doing that, of course. And we basically, that fee is paid for by primarily irrigated agriculture as the largest water user, but also by domestic water providers and small water systems as well. So we have a resource that we can tap that way. We also, by having approved plan and approved plan initially, and hopefully the others will be approved, we will be eligible for state and federal funds that we can pursue as well. And then finally, we can also ask the voters. We can look at a 218 question around some of these larger facilities, if that is the way that, you know, we look to go. And I want to just make sure everybody understands that the next work that we will do, which is pretty typical in any kind of planning work that any kind of water-based organization does, is we will be doing a series of engineering feasibility studies for some of these facilities that have been discussed. Without having engineer feasibility work done, many of these are ideas. And so we need to do that work next. And we've received some grant funding to do some of that right away. But feasibility is a very important part of planning for any water resource outcome. And so even though we've created our plans, they do have projects in them, that's the next set of work we will do. All of that engineering feasibility work will come through our board out to our stakeholders, and we'll be keeping people updated as these project ideas start to get actually analyzed, both through engineering as well as environmental and all the other things that would have to be considered in putting a project on the ground. So I hope that helps, but those are sort of the ways that we can look at the putting together the funding package. Ultimately, if there was a large project, it may look, you know, there may be some kind of 218 vote. I'm not saying that's absolutely where we're going, but those are the kinds of tools we can use for funding.
Comments from the other panelists?
I would like to comment. then Steve got in there before you did. One of the major funding issues is that funding can be segregated on a sub-basin basis. Even fees to run the agency, which I was a little surprised to learn. And a lot of the primary basis for different fees for the sub-basin is addressing benefit of a project. And South County farmers, and I'm sure Steve will want to address this,
yes,
will not necessarily benefit or won't benefit from solving the seawater intrusion problem. So again, we go back to the fragmentation. And again, this is the elephant in the room, which lots of people don't really want to address, but the inability to impose basin-wide fees without agreement from South County farmers is going to be a real challenge. And placing the burden, as I think Steve suggested, to address the problems in the seawater intruded area, placing that burden on jurisdictions is problematic as well. So that's my perspective. And Steve, I'm sure you have another perspective.
Well, thank you, Janet. And it's just a little bit different, but basically addressing the divide in agriculture. That divide has been around for decades, longer than I've actually been here. And we're going to solve that. And here's how we're going to solve it. You know, we were looking for the GSA or the state to solve it for many years. And finally, a group of us have gotten together, North and South, and said, look, this conflict paradigm can't go on. Because if we're divided, we're not going to be successful in becoming sustainable. So we've gotten together and we're working through our issues and we're going to be doing some modeling. And this modeling with the hydrologists and the USGS groundwater model will help us with our cost benefit analysis. As you mentioned, the Upper Valley and the Forebay did pay and do continue to pay for projects, the dams, the Salinas Valley Water Project. And that 218 vote took place because of a similar effort of ag to get together, North and South, and solve their issues. So Upper Valley and Forebay, I didn't mean to intimate that we would not be contributing to the costs or the expense of these projects. But how much we will be contributing would be determined by this effort. So separate from the GSA, agriculture is working to, you know, iron out its differences and come to agreement and provide solutions. So that's number one. Number two, just to address something else you mentioned, the feasibility of a system like the extraction barrier. Well, the Israelis have been doing it for years. In fact, that's where the idea came from. Israeli hydrologists that visited with a number of us agriculturists a few years ago and said, well, you guys might consider this, and bingo, you know, that the project concept was born. Yes, Donna's entirely correct. It is a concept with some good facts around it, and we'll endeavor to study the feasibility of that. I would also add that in the Oxnard Plain down in Southern California, Ventura County, they're a couple of years ahead of us in terms of an extraction barrier project, and their work looks extremely encouraging for our situation here. So, you know, and $1,000 an acre foot for water right now is prohibitive, but in Southern California, many citrus growers and berry growers are paying $1,500 an acre foot for now. I know my brother farms down there and I'm from that area, and water will get more expensive, but so will food. And the economics will still be there in the future. And that's starting to happen in the Central Valley where commodities like tomatoes are starting to realize, hey, we're going to have to pay the farmers more because otherwise we're not going to have these commodities. So it's complicated. It's going to take a long time, but I'm very optimistic that we can get there.
Thank you.
Just a quick response. I am delighted to hear about the effort to address this issue outside of the planning process. And it's really the first time I've heard of it. So all of you, you heard it first here. So thank you, Steve.
Welcome. John Farrow knows about it too. He and I have discussed it at length.
Thank you. Melody Krislock, if you could unmute yourself and ask your question, please.
Sure, thanks. So Steve, the extraction barrier that you're talking about, it sounds like it's coupled with a desal plant because you're talking about desalting water. Is that true? And if so, who would build and own this desal plant or desalter or whatever it is you're talking about?
Sure, reverse osmosis, and yeah, it's desalination. As I mentioned though, nothing on the scale of what's required for salt water. And the Israelis, 40% of the water they utilize for municipalities come from this type of technology. The biggest challenge is the permeate. So that's the salts that are removed. And they have some brineless solutions that they've developed that take advantage of wind, which we have plenty of, rather than return that material to the ocean. So there's a much better environmental process that's being developed or has been developed in Israel that we would be looking at. But to get to the heart of your question, there is a private company, Liberty Energy, that's looking at possibly developing a reverse osmosis area to do this work. We're not partnered with them. We're not even, you know, really talking to them right now, just to be aware that there is a company out there looking at this. They're a Canadian company, from what I understand. I don't know that much about it, but yes, we would have to build a plant someplace to take this water, treat it, and then distribute it to the municipalities.
Is there any reason that a brackish water desal plant like this can't be built and operated publicly by the county in some kind of a joint powers agency rather than farming it off to a private company?
There's no reason whatsoever, and that would all have to be worked out in the feasibility study.
And my question was actually two parts. Is the groundwater draw from the Cal Water in City of Salinas, is that actually creating the overdraft, substantial overdraft contributing to seawater intrusion in the 180-400?
To a great degree, yes, because the City of Salinas sits in what's called the cone of depression. And while I'm not a hydrologist, I've listened to them long enough to understand that the cone of depression, when you pump out of that area, you're drawing something into that area. So that's where the salt water tends to head. It heads inland and then north towards the City of Salinas. We get them off groundwater pumping. We no longer have that pressure gradient, or we've reduced it significantly.
Got it. Okay, that's what I understood. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. Next, if Allison Carr, I don't know how to pronounce your last name, mayor of Delray Oaks, would like to unmute and ask her question.
Thanks, Dennis. It's Kerr.
Kerr, thank you.
Like the jars. Thank you for having this conversation. It's one of many we will continue to have for quite a while, I'm assuming. I asked the question, Donna answered it, but I'd like to hear your thoughts. Are there plans for stormwater and or Salinas Valley River capture to help restore healthy aquifer levels?
Yeah, would you like me to take it first, Janet?
Sure. Sounds fun.
Yeah, so there are, as I mentioned, it's a portfolio of projects. So when we have excess water coming down the river, or we have storage that we're able to release as conservation releases, we're looking at augmenting the current capacity of the Castroville project is what we call CSIP, where water is taken out of the river and stored and then utilized in the 18400 for farmers to irrigate their crops. But as I mentioned, it's not drought proof. And in, you know, years like last year, it doesn't really, well, last year it did a fairly good job because, as I mentioned, we had storage. But this year and in the drought of 2014-16, it didn't run very much and farmers had to rely on groundwater pumping, which we want to get totally off of if we can in that area. So yes, we're definitely considering expanding that project and augmenting it in a number of different ways throughout the valley. On the east side, there's an opportunity to take water out utilizing the 11043 permit that the county has had forever. And supplying that water again when the river runs to communities on the east side or farmers on the east side as well.
That is a project. I think there's 138,000 acre feet of water available from the Salinas River that's unallocated that could be used, treated, and transported to jurisdictions that need a regional supply of water. And one of the benefits of that particular approach is that it's not limited by the prohibition of taking water out of the Salinas River or out of this groundwater basin. Water out of the groundwater basin has to go to areas within the Salinas Valley Basin. However, water from the river could be treated and transported outside the basin in areas such as Corral de Tierra, for example. But as Steve noted, it is not a drought-proof supply. But I think after it's going to be analyzed in the upcoming implementation process, and I think that it's going to be far more cost effective to approach a regional supply via that mechanism rather than desalinating brackish water. But we'll have to see what the technical analysis shows.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Beverly's question was about metering, which Donna said would be part of the planning process. But the real question is there any political will to be able to enforce the requirement for metering of agricultural use?
I'd like to thank you. That's a very good question. We have been we've had water meters or requirements to report extractions of all of our agricultural water from wells with a discharge diameter of 3 inches or larger, which is 95% of the wells in the Salinas Valley, for over 20 years. And I know our company, we report, in fact, the reports are due next, the 15th of February. And the Water Resource Agency has been collecting this data for, as I mentioned, over 20 years. The problem with the program is there hasn't been any calibration component. So that's really what's needed to ensure the accuracy of the current program. Not only that, but any, as I mentioned, discharge less than 3 inches is considered de minimis. And that needs to change as well, because in the Corral de Tierra area, Monterey sub-basin in particular, you've got over, I think, 160 or 170 de minimis users. I happen to be one, I live there. And we need to be involved in the solution as well. And we need that data with that many de minimis users to ensure that we're making informed decisions. So yes, we already have a program. Farmers have had it for quite a length of time. It needs to be tightened up. There needs to be enforcement. And we also need to decide whether new technologies that would allow us to report that data on the internet and save a lot of hand, you know, driving out to fields and such would be an important component as well.
Beverly, did you want to?
Yes, my question for Steve, isn't that reporting voluntary at this time? It's not a requirement.
No, it is not voluntary. I don't know anybody who's actually been, you know, the district attorney's gone after, but there is a $50 per day penalty for non-reporting after the deadline each year. And I think if you talk to the people at the Water Resource Agency, they will tell you there's a very high degree of compliance. The problem is, as I mentioned, calibration. We need to ensure that what we're reporting is accurate, and without a yearly or bi-yearly calibration effort, that casts some, you know, doubt on some of the veracity of the data.
Steve, I have a question. Some of the water metering is through estimation of energy use, isn't that correct?
Yeah, and people might balk at that, but let me explain how it happens. We have a couple of accounts like this. So if you're reporting your water usage according to electrical meter method, you're required to get a pump test. And that pump test determines the gallons per minute pumping of that particular well. That is, can be tied back mathematically to the kilowatt hours. And so it's actually, if you're not calibrating a regular water meter, the electrical method is more accurate because you are required to submit the pump test and the PG&E records. So you have two very reliable pieces of data that can be tied directly to the amount of water that you're pumping. So the electrical method is not necessarily any, it could be more accurate than the water meters without calibration.
Thank you. Question from Arlene Guest is, can the speakers address the causes of the drawdown in the Corral de Tierra area?
Too much pumping, water pumping. Plus,
well, actually, that and
well, that, let me finish. Please. Also, there is leakage into the Laguna Grande subbasin as well. So, between those two issues, you have an unsustainable groundwater situation. Now, one of the issues in the Corral area is high levels of arsenic. And in fact, one of the elementary schools can't let its students drink the water. They have to have bottled water. And the relationship between drawing down the groundwater and high levels of arsenic has not been fully established, but there is some concern that continued drawdown is going to exacerbate the problem. And one other reason for the problem is the county keeps approving projects in the Toro area. And we in the subbasin plan committee that Bev and I both served on ask that the GSA recommend to the county that it quit approving projects there, but that kind of fell flat. So there is some language there, but it's not very strong. So those are the three reasons we keep making the problem worse.
Yeah, Janet, that was great. And I don't know if Donna had the slide up, and it might be in her deck, but we had the hydrologist model turning off all of the pumping in the Monterey subbasin and to see what effect it would have on recovery. And with all the pumps turned off, or all the reported pumping turned off, the groundwater levels still declined. So as Janet mentioned, it's leaking in towards Laguna Seca. It's also leaking into the 18400. And I want to make that important distinction because that really ties two sub-basins together in terms of a regional solution.
Yeah, that's okay. Wondering was whether how connected these sub-basins are. And I know from personal experience, the arsenic is in the 400-foot basin and not in the 180 level, because we used to have a well at 180, but it was full of iron. But the 400, now we have the arsenic.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I'll start George Riley's question and he can unmute for a follow-up. He says, I'm concerned that analysis paralysis may preempt progress on the funding formula between the parties.
Yeah, I would like Steve to comment because he's the one that's talked about the funding side of it. Thank you.
Well, thank you, George, for your question. As I mentioned, the mandates that have that are involved in SGMA are going to force us to come to conclusions and solutions. We never had such a law before. And, you know, during the last 5 or 6, 7 years that this has been going on since 2014, there have been situations where we've asked the state to intervene, you know, where Marina had their late filing to become a GSA. You know, we said, DWR, you know, what are you doing here? Can't you, you know, intervene? And in the case of Arroyo Seco, when they filed their GSA, same situation. And each time, frustrating as it might be, the state pushed back and said, you guys figure it out. And the reason they're saying that, and I'm so glad they are, it gives us local control, but because if we don't succeed, they come in and take over. And that's adjudication. And that's a terribly expensive situation. So that's what's forcing us to come to the table and make this work. Are we going to get it done overnight? No. But we're going to get this done because we have such a jewel here. And we really need to protect it. And those of us who have been farming here for a long period of time, we realize that. And we don't want to turn it into houses. We want it to be ag ground. And I think everybody else should want that too, because then we can have a secure food supply.
If I can just follow up briefly, zones, the fundraising zones that have been created around the county's water resource agency, I assume those do not apply because you're going to have city jurisdictions like Salinas, for example, kind of in some kind of funding formula. I'm just wondering, are you thinking at all about a bond issue countywide, another 218 process, or is it going to be a hybrid of whatever?
It's more than likely going to be a 218 process that will include the municipal areas. As you mentioned, the farmers have been paying for the dams and the Salinas Valley Water Project via these districts like Zone 2C, and they don't include the entire county. And this solution will not include the entire county. Any of you living over in the peninsula will not be paying for a solution to this, more than likely. This is going to be locally funded. And as I said, ag is going to carry the lion's share of the cost.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's see. This question comes from a former supervisor who's hiding her name with a screen name of Jane P. If she wants to unmute for a follow-up, but I'll ask the question as it's written. How would the reverse osmosis costs be paid for if that option gets implemented? By whom and in what proportions?
Yeah, great question, Jane. Thank you. So, you know, that's yet to be determined, but I can give you a hypothetical because it would be very similar to paying for like the Salinas Valley Water Project. So you do as a cost-benefit analysis and you decide and agree on, you know, the Upper Valley is paying, let's say 15% of the project because, or 15% of the cost on a per acre basis because it's getting a 15% benefit. But the 18400, maybe they're paying 60% because they're getting more benefit. So you do this cost benefit analysis and you come up with these percentages and you agree on them or you don't, but you go to a 218 vote and you decide what the district, how big the district is going to be that's going to pay for these. And then you have an economic analysis that says, okay, it's going to cost this much per acre of property, or it's going to cost this much per connection, or it's going to cost this much per acre foot. So maybe the funding is based, or the paying for the project is based upon usage and extraction. So those are the three types of things that would go into it. For the Salinas Valley Water Project, we pay on a per acre basis based upon a formula where the upper valley pays less than the 18,400, and everybody in between has a different percentage as well.
I would like to provide a note of caution. The Monterey County Water Resource Agency has been trying for 1 or 2 years to establish a 218 vote for the maintenance of the dams, and has been totally unable to get agreement among the agricultural community regarding how the assessment should be, because there's significant disagreement about who benefits and how much they benefit. And so that the maintenance of the dam is the dams is critical, but so far the county has been County Water Resources Agency has been unable to get agreement. And again, it is this classic north-south split, and you know it goes both ways. The North County farmers are saying we don't benefit from the dam, and the South County farmers get all the benefit. So it's the same action as it relates to seawater intrusion, but in the reverse.
Well, Janet, you're correct. But we've made a recent headway on that problem. And the issue with the dam maintenance is there's no mandate other than the DSOD saying that we can't store as much water in San Antonio until we fix the dam. There's no mandate like there is with SGMA that's going to force us to get there. And as I said, we're going to solve that maintenance situation. We've got people talking, and we'll get there because we know it has to be done.
Thank you. Let's see, Gail Morton, if you would unmute and ask your question. I'll start it. Is the fee structure Donna describes subject to the 218 process, or is it exempt? And someone could also remind me what the 218 process is.
Well, I'm sure there are people that would do a better job of describing the 218 than I would. It's complicated. It's basically a vote, but you can have a vote of a certain percentage of property owners to approve it, or a vote of a certain percentage of people who oppose it. It's very complicated, and Les Gerard would be the best to explain this. He's explained it to us, but maybe Janet understands it better than I do. But the fees are many times different than that's completely different than a 118 vote, a 218 vote for a project. The GSA can assess fees for certain things, and we have done that, but I doubt we would ever use that to build a project.
Well, the fees are generally for planning and implementation, yeah. And 218 fees are generally for projects. Right. But even based on Les Gerard's comment at our last meeting, the fees can be allocated on the basis of benefit as well, but they are not subject to a voter approval.
Can I just throw a comment in, please? The 218 process is a vote by property owners.
Right.
Not just residents and citizens and that kind of version. Since we're the women for the League of Women Voters, I just wanted to clarify the voter side of a 218 process. It's property owners.
You're right. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. This comes from Marley. We'd heard that the data you submit may be substantially understating the actual water use. What are you doing to ascertain actual water use?
Well, that's a good question. Thank you. And I want to call your attention to the fact that the USGS model, the historic benefit USGS model, underreported actual water use by 30%, according to what we call GEMS, the Groundwater Extraction Management Program reporting. So it was really interesting to us that the model underreported groundwater pumping. And when we all, as farmers, realized that, we brought it to the attention of the GSA and said, that ain't right. And so they went back to USGS and calibrated the model to the GEMS data that has been, as I said, for over 20 years. So if we're underreporting, we're in big trouble, but I don't really think that's the case on most of the data that's been submitted.
I would just like to thank Steve and Donna for this, but I also want to note that this is the most complex, obtuse planning process that I have ever been involved in. And if people are confused, welcome to the crowd, because it is very, very, not only is the planning process itself complex, but the hydrology, the modeling, and all of that is exceptionally complicated and not readily accessible to the lay public. So that's my observation about Sigma. And I don't know, Steve, would you agree?
Oh yeah, I would agree. But I think that's part of the beauty in terms of the design, is it is unwielding and it involves so many moving parts, but that's what makes it so public and transparent.
Well, what a beautiful glass half full note on which thank you, Steve. And thank you, Janet, and in absentia, thanks to Donna for really what is the beginning of a graduate level seminar on a critically important topic for all of us who want to be responsible citizens. I hope we can continue the dialogue.
Thank you. Absolutely. Thank you,
everyone, for excellent questions today.
Yes.